Contrary to what the health teacher tried to drill into your heads in middle school, it can be pretty hard to make a baby. And if fertility isn't coming easily, you might find yourself in a bizarre corner of the internet where people tell you to change your underwear and your chair and pretty much everything in your life because somehow that's all lowering your sperm count. While some of these claims are just not true, there is peer-reviewed academic literature to support others. So here are a few of the sperm quality claims that we have heard here at SciShow and the science, or lack thereof, behind them. To start, let us go over how sperm gets made. These swimmers come from a very specific environment in your testes, and if it gets too hot in there, the sperm can come out with issues, which is why a lot of the things on this list are about what keeps the scrotum from overheating. But it's not all about temperature. There are plenty of other potential causes for messed up sperm cells, like lubricants, which you may be using during sex, because they certainly can have upsides, but some may have a downside. It indeed does turn out that most vaginal lubricants are bad for sperm. And if you didn't know that, you're not alone. In a survey of healthcare professionals published in 2019, none of them were aware of lubricant-related guidance for people trying to conceive. Despite this lack of general wisdom around lube and its effects on your sperm, there is research that suggests it can do damage. Your little swimmers can lose 49% of their movement control when swimming through even a tiny amount of lube, and it's not because they're slipping all over the place. Researchers think that certain lubricants break down the membranes on a sperm's tail, degrading it until it is less effective. And it can be tough to know which ones are safe when you're shopping, because products labeled non-spermicidal may still have this problem. So the authors of this study concluded that most vaginal lubricants are sperm toxic and are not a recommended part of the conception cocktail. The good news is that this study was able to identify one sperm-safe option, and there is likely more out there, but most lube is not great for sperm, according to those studies. So this one, true. While we're talking about sex, let's tackle another rumor. Some people say that ejaculation too recently before sex leaves you with semen that will not get the job done. This is true at least sometimes, but kind of depends on what you mean by recent or frequent. One study found that sperm counts and motility were reduced in second and third ejaculations, so rounds two and three would be less potent. However, a different study found exactly the opposite. Not only were round two swimmers more concentrated, they had higher motility as well. So it's hard to say for sure what's going on here. Everyone who makes sperm does it at a different rate, which could be part of the discrepancy. In any case, sperm count builds back up again after several days, although the number of days really depends on the individual. Some people need about a week between rounds to get things back to normal. For others, two times a day might be totally fine. So this one, mixed. Now that we know to skip the third round of the day and avoid lube if you can while still enjoying the ride, we can get to the question on everyone's minds: boxers or briefs? In terms of preference, a 2016 study in the US found that people are almost evenly split three ways across boxer briefs, boxers, and briefs. There is a slight preference for boxer briefs, and very few people wear briefs at night, but other than that, they're worn at similar levels. And it could matter which one you prefer, because boxers are looser, and therefore cooler, at least temperature-wise. I have no clue which is more fashionable. But the thing is, that temperature benefit is less than 1 degree. An analysis of semen quality based on sperm shape, sperm maturity, and DNA found no consistent effect of underwear style. While there were a few differences in the sperm shape, some were beneficial and others were detrimental. So they didn't translate into any ability to predict who would end up having babies and who wouldn't, which means this one is busted. While the underwear you choose probably will not affect your fertility, other choices you make can crank the heat too high for sperm. Like when you use a laptop. Or rather, how you use a laptop. Holding your laptop where the name says to, on your lap, increases the heat in your scrotum and can cause sperm defects in as little as 11 minutes. But that heat actually is mainly from your body, not the computer. See, to balance a laptop in place, most people need to keep their legs together, and the lack of airflow and concentration of body heat that this position causes is enough to spike the temperatures that could be dangerous for your swimmers. But there is a way around this. A small study found that Manspreading and adding a pad to your lap to hold your computer up could nearly triple the amount of time it takes to elevate scrotal temperature by 1 degree Celsius. And a lot of studies support the idea that you can't make new sperm as effectively at even just 1 degree hotter. So that really does make a difference. So studies like this one demonstrate that how you sit matters at least a little, and that there's a medical benefit to manspreading. But you don't need to go all the way wide, especially if you're on public transit. This one is true. As it turns out, it's not just how you sit that can make a difference in your sperm quality. What you are sitting on matters too. A small Finnish study compared 6 commonly used chairs to see which, if any, made a difference in how hot your undercarriage gets. They found that it only took 20 minutes to significantly increase scrotal temperature by 3 degrees Celsius in multiple kinds of chairs. The one that did not end up with that temperature increase? The saddle chair. It might be better at dissipating the heat because the shape of a saddle chair doesn't support your scrotum, so some chairs are better than others for keeping things cool down there. True. Now, the type of chair isn't the only factor. Some research suggests that how cushioned it is could also matter. So in a small South Korean experiment, men sat on chairs with varying cushion thickness, and their scrotal temperature was measured for 2 hours. The question was whether or not the insulation from extra cushioning interferes with heat dissipation. And it did not. With the thickest cushion tested coming in at 8 centimeters, average scrotal temperature increased anywhere from 0.85 to 1.6 degrees Celsius, which still left them within the normal temperature range. One cushion didn't change average testy temperature at all, and that wasn't even the thinnest cushion. So you can't necessarily make a statement about thicker cushions leading to hotter testes. That one is just not true. And now, for a note from our sponsor.
Thank you for watching this SciShow video, and thank you to this month's Presidents of Science, McLaren Stanley and Charlie Stanley, for supporting it. If you saw a graphic you liked or learned a new fun fact in this video, you can thank Presidents Stanley for commissioning all of that stuff. Okay, so it's not that official. We can kind of make whatever we think y'all will like. And that's because our presidents are so cool and give us the funding and freedom to do that. You can learn more about our presidential fund at patreon.com/scishow.
With the emergence of COVID as a global pandemic, lots of people were left wondering what it could do to the world, and one side effect that you might not have thought to worry about is sperm count. Since a lot of illnesses result in fever, the idea of getting sick and then having your sperm pay the price is not new or specific to COVID. Generally, a fever has been associated with short-term reversible decreases in sperm output and movement, among other factors. But some experts have suggested that these effects on sperm might be worse in COVID cases because the fever lasts longer. There may be long-term effects months after the fever, according to some studies. So this rumor is sounding true, at least with the info we have now. Just one more reason to get vaccinated. True. Okay, so maybe it's not that surprising that getting sick isn't great for our sperm, but surely stuff that's good for our health would be good for our sperm too, like bicycling? Some researchers have proposed that depending on how you ride your bike and for how long, you can put too much pressure on your perineal region and crunch a nerve or cut off circulation down there, leading to the dreaded numb penis, among other problems. Wait a second, what? This is based off of old research, including a survey of 160 bikers. 33 of them said that they had a numb penis after riding their bikes, and 10 of them said the numbness lasted over a week. I would quit. More worryingly, the authors of the study said that 21 were impotent after riding. For 11 of them, it lasted for more than a week, and for 3 of them, it lasted for more than a month. The longest effect in this survey was one cyclist whose impotence lasted for 8 months. That's pretty scary, but that participant might be an outlier, since most of the participants did not go numb. And most of the people who did reported that things went back to normal within the same day. Also, there seemed to be things that you could do to avoid this problem. Research suggests that finding a good bike fit and a saddle that doesn't protrude too far forward can reduce perineal pressure by 66% and drastically reduce numbness. The difference maker is how pressure gets redistributed across short nose seats. So this particular rumor can be true depending on how you ride your bike. The question is whether there's really anything special about cyclists compared to other athletes. When compared to soccer players, or footballers as this European study called them, there was no statistical difference in sexual performance. While way more of cyclists had perineal numbness, it did not affect their erectile function scores. So this rumor may be true, but there may be other sports with similar issues too. Mixed. Now, if you're trying to save your sperm, avoiding all sports altogether might not be the answer either, since excess weight is another factor that can harm your sperm quality. Inactivity is linked to excess weight, which can lead to oxidative stress or a buildup of free radicals in the body. And that buildup can damage the DNA in your sperm and has been associated with infertility. I know that's a lot of maybes that have to be true for the whole chain to link up, and that may be why the literature is ultimately pretty mixed on whether or not obesity has consistent effects on sperm. But the most balanced publications seem to indicate a small, measurable effect. One study found that fat itself wasn't correlated with sperm issues, but an increased body mass index was associated with lower levels of a specific hormone called inhibin B, which can be a sign that sperm formation isn't going well. That said, the effect of weight on sperm may also have to do with heat, as excess fat in the thighs and lower abdomen could provide insulation to the scrotum. Even if the effects are somewhat small, the research does support that obesity is correlated to worse sperm counts. True. Another lifestyle change that could make a difference for your sperm is drinking. Several meta-analyses concluded that alcohol consumption is associated with reduced semen volume. And oxidative stress may be the culprit in this case as well, or it could come down to hormonal effects. One of the meta-analyses found a decrease in some of the main hormones regulating reproduction, and that could reasonably be linked to decreased fertility. We know that excessive alcohol intake is bad for your health in a lot of ways, so it does make sense that it would be bad for your sperm too. The bright side of this story is that you don't necessarily need to cut out all alcohol to improve your reproductive output. The paper concluded that there was a bigger difference between daily and occasional drinkers than there was between occasional drinkers and non-drinkers. So it doesn't seem like the occasional cold one is gonna do you too much harm. So this one's mixed. When researchers wanted to study this last rumor, they inadvertently solved an age-old debate that has plagued the internet for forever. How would a dog wear pants? Dogs are mammals, just like us, so when one research group wanted to know how fabrics like polyester affected sperm quality, they turned to dogs for the answer. They put polyester underpants on some dogs and cotton ones on other dogs, and they let the final group of dogs run around naked like dogs. The dogs wearing polyester pants had damaged sperm after 2 years of being fashion icons, while the other two groups of dogs were both fine. Then, in a follow-up study conducted in the 90s, those researchers asked men to wear a polyester sling around their reproductive organs, because science is weird sometimes, and after 1 year, these men had smaller testicles and even had degeneration of their seminiferous tubules, the place where the sperm cells are made. More importantly, all participants lost fertility while wearing this sling. After an average of 139 days, all 14 participants became azoospermic, meaning they were shooting blanks. These researchers even suggested that polyester slings could be a safe method of contraception because the effects were reversible. This might happen because polyester generates an electrostatic field across your scrotum. They could even pick up that electrostatic response using something called a kilovolt meter, which sounds to me like polyester pants really can affect your sperm counts. True. I'm surprised. And for the answer we've all been waiting for, the dogs wore their pants on their back legs only. Case closed. So there we have it, the truth and the myths around what can impact your sperm quality according to current science. Whether you are trying to conceive or barely think about your little guys, it's always good to be able to separate fact from fiction, especially if doing so means putting dogs into funny outfits.